Hi, I'm Carl. Welcome to Musicians with Guitars Drinking Wine. Tonight we're going to be using double cutaway solid body electric guitars made in 1960 by Gibson. And we're honored to have the fabulous SpinCycle. Steve C. will be using a 1960 Gibson Les Paul Jr. Jen will be using a rare Gibson Les Paul Jr. 3/4 size. John will be playing a 1960 Gibson SG Special. At least that's what Gibson called it in the catalogs, but we all know it as a Les Paul Special. Steve L. will be using a rare, seldom seen 1960 first version of the EB0 bass. Also with us tonight, John, Dave, and Mitch. And now, fun with Gibson's name game. Gibson's new solid body, the Les Paul model, made its debut in 1952. 2 years later, in 1954, Gibson offered a budget or student model with a slab body and one pickup. In Sunburst, it was called the Les Paul Jr., and the same guitar in a limed mahogany finish was named the Les Paul TV model. One theory for that name choice was that the lighter color would look good on TV. A year later, in 1955, a two-pickup version was introduced called the Les Paul Special. It was only available in the limed mahogany finish. In 1958, Gibson introduced their first double cutaway guitar, the ES-335. Midway through 58, they expanded the double cutaway concept to the budget line solid bodies. The single pickup yellow guitar was still called the Les Paul TV model, but the Les Paul Jr. was changed from Sunburst to a new see-through red color. And the two pickup version was now available in the same two colors, but both were called the Les Paul Special. By 1960, though, things took an odd turn. The red single pickup kept its name, the Les Paul Jr., but the light-colored version was renamed the SG-TV model, and the two-pickup version, in either color, became the SG-Special. Part of the reason these names are a source of confusion today is that in 1961, Gibson redesigned the entire Les Paul line, with all of the models adopting a sharp beveled-edged body, which is another story altogether. This beveled edge body has since become known as the SG shape. But the light-colored single pickup guitar and both colors of the two-pickup special adopted the SG name way back in 1960. Today, though, they are universally referred to as Les Paul TV Juniors and Les Paul Specials, despite their actual catalog names. Tonight we're doing something different. We're trying something from the California Wine Club. It's a Campus Oaks...
Old Vine Zinfandel.
What do you think?
I like it.
It's very tasty.
Oh, go for it.
Yeah, second bottle's better than the first.
Right, pass the bottle.
I'll finish this one. I really love the look of these late 50s double cutaway guitars, especially the Special.
This is fantastic. The reaction I had when I strapped this guitar on, it was like a glove. The weight was perfect. The neck shape. I have smaller hands, so this fit my hand perfectly, and it sounds awesome for being as old as I am. Yeah, I am kind of curious about these pickups with the plastic covers. That was typical for those guitars of that day.
That's a P90. Gibson introduced those pickups at the end of World War II, and throughout the 50s, they were their main pickup. And yes, it has a plastic cover. Well, at least it did until 1963. Gibson said that the P90 delivered smooth, warm tone instead of harsh, trebly tone. And of course, by that, they meant Fender.
Right.
The P90s are smooth and warm, but once you crank the amp up a little bit, they have a fabulous rock and roll edge.
I had a Les Paul recording model, like a 72 or 73. So right away, the weight is very different on this guitar to that guitar.
Well, that's for sure.
And it's very comfortable to play. I mean, I just can't... I find it amazing. It feels good. It just and sounds nice through the vintage Fender Deluxe amplifier. Really enjoy playing it.
If you have a Les Paul recording, that has so many knobs and controls, it's like the exact opposite of this guitar.
Yeah, right.
Exactly. It's totally stripped out, which I kind of like that too. I think the only downside right now is that I'm probably going to have to look for one of these in my budget. It's kind of tough.
Better get more gigs, Steve.
When I was young, I thought a Gibson Les Paul Jr. meant it was a smaller guitar. I didn't realize that Gibson used the term Jr. to mean a one pickup guitar. It turns out they did make a version of the Les Paul Jr. in a smaller 3/4 size guitar.
Mm-hmm. And it's cute. I like it.
So this guitar is a one pickup guitar and a three-quarter size guitar. It's both.
Junior, junior.
Exactly. Yeah. It's a junior, junior. Getting to this bass, I know you generally play a long scale Fender bass. Does the short scale length on this bass bother you?
No, it actually plays like butter. I really like it. I'm just used to a longer neck.
A few more frets.
But it's nice, yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't take a long time to get used to it. Is what I'm trying to say. Mm-hmm.
Gibson's first bass was a violin-shaped bass, the EB1. In 1959, they replaced it with this bass, but for some reason they went backwards with the numbering system and called this one an EB0. Although now, of course, we just refer to it as an EBO.
Was the violin shape before the Hofner?
Gibson introduced their violin-shaped bass in 1953. Hofner didn't release theirs until 1955. But when you think about it, an upright bass is violin-shaped, so both the Gibson and the Hofner were really just mimicking an upright bass.
Sure.
I doubt that Hofner was copying Gibson.
I just noticed that. It's got that SG shape. The back.
Well, that's just another carryover from the upright bass design.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I can't believe I didn't notice
rather
that.
Rather than reaching around.
Right. Yeah. Right. Carl, right. Do you ever talk about the drums on your show?
Not that often.
it's not drummers drinking wine.
I think the camera just went off.
When I was told that we were going to be invited to play on your show, I knew what I was going to be playing was going to be a great old Ludwig drum set, which are my favorite drums. A Keystone late 60s or early 70s Ringo style kit with a 13-16, floor tom. And a great acrolyte snare, and this is heaven for me, being able to sit behind this drum set.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
And I can tie that into these guitars. You guys can't see the snare drum from here, but the Ludwig acrolyte snare drum was a budget version of their chrome snare. But it sounds wonderful. It's my favorite snare drum.
I have one at home that I use all the time.
So that snare drum was meant to be a budget snare drum, and these guitars are meant to be budget guitars. But in reality, they stand the test of time. They're wonderful rock and roll instruments. So there, I've tied the drums into the story.
Yes.
How long have you been together?
In this configuration, it's just been about 18 months, but a few of us have been together almost 10 years.
I really like the song you wrote for tonight. It's a fun tune.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. Steve Castelli actually penned that one. We're really pleased with it, and I think we're going to end up playing it out on a regular basis.
I was walking to work one day and just started wine, and it just came from there.
It's from there.
Also, it's also descriptive of our lifestyle.
Yes. Must have been, yeah. I'm a Grand Marnier guy, but I... follow suit.
Oh,
whatever works. Does Steve write most of your songs?
Actually, no. Actually, Dave Seaman, our keyboard player, is our primary.
Our fearless leader.
Yeah. Yeah. But the one thing that's been exciting for our band, I think, is that, you know, Dave's written a bunch of originals.
Yeah.
We've been introducing the originals in our sets. And, you know, at first, people like familiar music, so they might not be as receptive. But little by little, people we know in France are starting to hum those songs and, hey, are you going to play a song tonight? And so it's really a nice feeling to really be creative and do these original songs.
What drew me to be a full-time member of SpinCycle was Dave's originals. And they're so eclectic, anywhere from literally from like power pop to Burt Bacharach and everywhere in between. Dave has written some really great songs, so props to him.
I got that $10 for you afterwards.
Yeah, that's right. And one of these days, one of these days, we will have a CD release party. We keep changing the year, keeps getting it. We're going to get there.
Changing the year, but it's all right.
But aren't CDs old school?
Well, I think we'll be hip to the, you know, download.
It'll be a download CD.
Right. I think it'll be a download party, yes.
Right, exactly.
I guess the downside to this conversation is we sound like a bunch of old people.
We're like my dad.
Isn't
like
that
dad.
Amazing? Hey,
Carl, this version of it should be old people drinking wine.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. I think we have to embrace it. That's one of the things that I appreciate playing music at this age, though, is we do have that long catalog, a huge inventory. Matter of fact, it's challenging to pick those songs that we think we like and will go over in front of an audience, but the choices are endless, which is great. And that makes it a lot of fun.
On that note, here's SpinCycle with Wine Oh Wine.
feeling fine. I'm not much about getting high. You can have your beer at Miller time. I like my drink straight from the vine. Wine, oh, wine, oh, wine, oh, wine. Every day I pops a cork. Or two just for relaxing, socializing, or when life gets taxing. Champagne when I'm feeling classy. Celebrations and feeling sassy. Wine, oh, wine, oh, wine, oh, wine. Give me a glass and I'm feeling fine. I'm not much about getting high. And you can have your beer at Miller time. I like my drink straight from the vine.
In the late 1950s, Gibson sometimes put white pickguards on guitars displayed at the National Association of Music Merchants, or NAMM, trade show. This Les Paul Jr. three-quarter size with its original white pickguard was on display at the 1960 NAMM show.